Hey there once again, YouTube. I just wanted to bring your attention to something. I know I already did a video today, but I just really quick want to show you something about Long Valley Caldera Supervolcano. But first off, we had two major quakes, multiple quakes actually, but two of them were major. There's a 6.1 near Tonga, supposedly at 10 kilometers in depth. Nobody reported feeling it. But down here, there's a magnitude 7.2 at 34.4 kilometers in depth at 2255 UTC on June 15, 2019. The DigiFuel report says shaking was very strong from the locals in this area. Zooming in just real fast. Let's see where this was located. And on the recent earthquakes page on my website, which is a new page that I sometimes update, I do have plots of the closest seismic station and the teleseismic signature of this magnitude 7.2. And we can see it occurred on the Kermadec. Please let me know if I'm saying that correctly. Here, let's go to terrain. Let me show you. Going to terrain, we see the Kermadec Islands. Kermadec, right? I'm terrible at pronouncing things. You guys, if you guys watch my videos, you know I'm terrible at pronunciation of new words that I don't know. Of course, if I already know the words, I know how to pronounce them. But we see the Kermadec Trench right here, which sees a huge amount of seismicity throughout decades and decades of monitoring. I mean, they see 8s, 9s, sometimes 7s. Multiple sixes all the time. I mean, they get slammed pretty hard in this location, but we had a magnitude 7.2 again at 34.4 kilometers in depth, just the north-northeast of New Zealand, more to the northeast, just south of the Kermadec Islands. Now let's go to my website just real fast. Here we are at my website, monitorseize.net. Again, a link to my website will always be in the description box right under my email address, so go check that out if you want. And down here, we're going to see the plots to this. A very strong magnitude 7.2 strikes the Kermadec Trench south of the Kermadec Islands and north of New Zealand. Locals reported strong shaking. Station RAO is the closest available station to the epicenter for data download, while MCID in Idaho shows the teleseismic signature. Here it is zoomed in a little bit. This is the teleseismic signature of the magnitude 7.2 near the Kermadec Islands. This is from Station MCID, which resides in Idaho, just on the southwestern tip of Yellowstone National Park, so thousands of kilometers away from the epicenter, and we see the attenuated frequencies, meaning because a teleseism with global earthquakes usually above 6.0, the frequencies drop dramatically thousands of kilometers away, because distance, frequencies attenuate, meaning they get lower with distance. For example, the closer you are to the epicenter, the higher the frequencies are going to be, right? And no, low frequencies have nothing to do with depth. Someone told me someone said that, and no, they have nothing to do with depth. Depth is constrained by completely other parameters, and you need multiple stations to discover depth, basically. Going forward, here is the local event right here from one of the closest seismic stations. Actually, this is the closest seismic station. Station RAO in the IU network, 10 location code, broadband vertical, with a 1 Hz high pass filter. It was very strong, lasted quite a while. From here to here is 30 whole seconds. So they got shook up pretty hard down there, but that's not what I want to talk about right now. So the video I uploaded earlier today talked about an extremely minor rapid fire swarm of Yellowstone. I mean, just a few events, probably maximum magnitude 2, if that, near Yellowstone Lake. But that wasn't the main course. The main course of that video was talking about a rapid fire swarm at Long Valley Caldera, which is possibly a more dangerous, a more dangerous supervolcano in California, right in this location right here. Now, they already discovered an immense amount of melt beneath Long Valley Super-Volcano, which is a caldera, one of the Earth's largest calderas. One of the largest, guys. I mean, it's pretty big. You can see the caldera outlined from space if you're in the International Space Station. I mean, it's pretty big, guys, pretty big. We do see an earthquake swarm is occurring, but no, this is not the earthquake swarm I talked about earlier. The rapid fire swarm that I talked about earlier, I am making an analysis page on, including the minor rapid fire swarm at Yellowstone, too. Both of those, I'm doing an analysis page on, but now I have to do a third one. I haven't even gotten those two pages up yet. And now I have to do a third one for another rapid fire swarm just east of Mammoth Lakes, California, which is right, pretty much right in the center of Long Valley Caldera, a supervolcano which currently houses 240 cubic miles of magma. If it erupted at full potential today, it would likely be thousands. I'm talking probably over 2,000 to 3,000 times more powerful than the Mount St. Helens eruption. I mean, it would be catastrophic. But a whole new caldera forming eruption is much less likely than lava flows or minor to moderate ash eruptions. Now, I'm not at all saying that's going to happen. I mean, there was multiple sixes in one day back in 1980 and 1979. I mean, they were getting slammed. From 1979 to 2014, there was 2.5 feet of uplift at Long Valley Caldera, including tens of thousands of earthquakes, multiple magnitudes. I mean, it was getting pretty concerning, guys. It was getting very, very concerning. Thank God that it calmed down. Otherwise, it would have led to a super eruption, or at least something close to a super eruption. At least it would have been worse than Mount St. Helens. And interesting how it started to really gain momentum in May 1980. The same month and the same year as the Mount St. Helens eruptions. That's weird. That's a weird coincidence, isn't it? But I'm getting off topic, and we see 36 reported earthquakes from Mammoth Lakes, just east of Mammoth Lakes, right in the southern, central southern section of Long Valley Caldera, supervolcano. And I believe the largest today, let's see here for a second, largest magnitude first, magnitude 2.8 at 1349 UTC, which was earlier today, I believe. That was the first rapid fire swarm. Calmed down for about an hour or two, maybe even longer. And then just as of the past hour or so, we have another rapid fire swarm that is appearing. And it's strange because Long Valley's swarms aren't necessarily always in the rapid fire category. And I'm fascinated with these types of swarms that are very energetic. I'm not talking about huge magnitudes. You know, they can be anywhere from magnitude 0 to magnitude 3, even maybe magnitude 4. Nothing crazy, not the magnitudes, it's the energy that I'm very interested in. And you know that one of the most interesting swarms I'm interested in is the ones at Yellowstone, around Yellowstone Lake, Westham Lake, Shoshone Lake, and Lewis Lake, that see those rapid-fire, very energetic swarms with small to moderate magnitudes. Very interested in those. And usually I do not see these at Long Valley. But today we had two rapid-fire swarms. The second one is occurring right now. Let's quickly go to volcanoes.usgs.gov just real quick. And here we are. Just to take a look at the closest seismic station, which would be MCS. And they have not updated the station yet, meaning that this is still an old, old station, guys. It barely even records data beyond 2000 amplitude count, which is very low, very low. But you can still see the duration of the events, though, which can still help you judge somewhat of an accurate magnitude, because they have multiple ways they judge magnitudes, and many of which I'm still not familiar with, but one I am familiar with would be MD, which would be magnitude duration, or duration magnitude. So, why don't we go take a look at this earthquake swarm right now from this seismic station, MCS. The waveforms are not going to look too good again, because this is an old seismic station. But then again, it's still a good one to use. So now here we have the most recent data stream from station MCS in the NC network. No location code given, so that'd be dash dash. Short period vertical EHZ, so we do not need a frequency filter right now. Okay, so earlier we did talk about this in my last video, the one right before this, how there was a rapid fire storm. Again, look at how the waveforms look weird. Look at that. That is because it rarely goes beyond 2000 amplitude count, because this is an old, old seismic station. This is typical of seismic stations probably added to the area, maybe, I'm going to guess, maybe the late 1990s to the early 2000s, maybe even 2005, 2006 or so. But after that, they really need to put in a new seismic station in this location. I hate looking at waveforms that look like this. I'm sorry. I mean, I know you can still understand what is going on, but it's just annoying, in my opinion. But we can still see what is occurring. No, except some of these events do have dominant low frequencies. They're not technically low frequency earthquakes, which would be indicative of fluid or magma itself. Remember, low-frequency earthquakes usually are caused by magma or magmatically derived hydrothermal fluids or something like that. Like, it's usually not just tectonic in nature, but then again, volcanic activity can occur with very little to almost no low-frequency background tremor or low-frequency earthquakes. However, that's somewhat rare. Usually, there has to be some type of low-frequency event present, if you know what I mean. So again, this is the old earthquake storm that occurred earlier today. I made an analysis page about this. It's not up yet. I'll let you guys know when that's up, and the analysis page from the Yellowstone swarm. And moving forward, we saw just one more quake, some surface activity, and then let's scroll all the way down. And then down here, we saw the teleseism, the teleseismic signature, to the magnitude 7.2 in the Kermadec Islands. You could tell that is the teleseism right there. And it looks a little bit more attenuated here, even though this station at Long Valley Caldera is closer to the epicenter, to the magnitude 7.2, than the ones at Yellowstone. But the thing is I believe this is because it passed through magma. This is not harmonic tremor, this is a teleseismic signature, But do you want to know how sometimes they detect magma chambers? They use teleseismic signatures and how long they are recorded, right? That's why magma chambers can also be called low velocity zones, or LVZs. Look that up. Seriously, type in seismic low velocity zone, and it usually will indicate some type of thick fluid down there, which is almost always magma. I mean, maybe hydrothermal in some cases, but almost always magma. Low velocity zones is basically another word for a magma chamber. Then right here, we see a regional earthquake. Don't know exactly which one this is. This occurred at 149 UTC. Let's go check that out right now. 149 UTC. Go to the world. Do this first. 149 UTC. Let's go all the way down. Ah, right here. Remember, it takes a few seconds to arrive on a seismic station, depending on where it occurred. But there's a magnitude 3.2 at 2.1 kilometers in depth near the Coso Junction in California, which is not too far from Long Valley. And so right there, we see the regional seismic signature. Remember, there are three types of signatures for earthquakes you will see. Teleseismic, regional, or local. This is regional. Here's a great, actually, this day is a great example, guys. Okay, this is a regional earthquake. Mid-range frequencies, you could tell that's definitely a regional earthquake. Separated P and S wave arrivals. Now going up, this is a teleseismic signature right here from a global distant large earthquake. But these earthquakes right here are local earthquakes. See? Teleseismic, regional, and local. So again, earlier in this day, we saw multiple earthquakes occurring as somewhat of a rapid fire swarm, kind of like what we see at Yellowstone a lot of the time. And scrolling down right down here, we see the rapid fire swarm has reignited and is again occurring once again. One earthquake right there going forward. Multiple earthquakes, look at them. They are occurring in rapid succession, so this can be characterized as a rapid fire swarm, which are one of my favorite swarms to analyze. I mean, some of the swarms that are just singular earthquakes, yeah, they can be important, especially if their magnitudes are large. But I'm mainly focused on these because it sometimes shows something trying to break through the ground, right? I mean, if something very viscous, kind of like magma or even very powerful hydrothermal fluids that are very hot, it would break through the crust a lot. You know what I'm saying? Like, it wouldn't just be like an earthquake here, an earthquake there, an earthquake here, an earthquake there. It would be very fast because it's trying to break through and it's trying to get free, right? So, sorry if I'm doing a bad explanation, but that's just my explanation on it. This rapid fire swarm seems to be a little less severe than the one earlier in the day up here somewhere. Now, look at this. Look at all those earthquakes. Those are all earthquakes, guys. Very tiny, though. Only going up to 300 amplitude count on this station. Remember, though, this station is terrible at recording amplitude count. I hope NCEDC, the Northern California Data Center, I really hope they put out new instruments here soon. Not seeing any low-frequency earthquakes. There might be a little bit of low-frequency background tremor, but that might... I looked at a separate station. Don't know if that is for sure or not. I don't know. You guys have to figure that out if you want. More earthquakes going up to about 1,700 amplitude count or so. Four in a row. Look at that. One, two, three, four within about, what is that? 16, I gotta scroll this down. My bad, guys. At about 16:03:53 to 16, oh, whoops. Wow, I'm an idiot. 353 UTC to 353:40 UTC. Wow. Just in about 40 seconds, we saw four earthquakes right there. Yeah, that's definitely a rapid fire swarm, guys. More earthquakes, and right here we see another earthquake. And moving forward, it seems to have stopped as of 4:01:30 UTC. Going forward, not seeing much else. There are a few tiny microquakes, but that's pretty much it. So I will do another analysis page. I will make a third analysis page about this rapid fire swarm on my website tomorrow. I still haven't even got up the other two pages. So just keep an eye out for that. And there's one more thing I want to tell you guys about just real quick. Now you might be wondering, why am I on the website for 95.5 My Country, which is a somewhat popular country music station in Wyoming. And again, Yellowstone Supervolcano is where Wyoming is located. I noticed when, because every once in a while, about once per month, I search my own name on Google to see if anybody's talking about me or if my name has gone out there or whatever. I found something very interesting. On March 12, 2019, 95.5 My Country wrote an article about me. And same on May 1st, 2019, both by the same person, Doc Holliday. Now, this is not just a singular person with a blog. Guys, this is an actual organization. This is a pretty popular radio station in Wyoming. I don't think they talked about me on radio. I'm pretty sure they didn't. Actually, I wouldn't even know if they did because they didn't contact me about this. But it's pretty amazing, guys. I really like that my name actually got out there and is on a radio station's website. I mean, even though they're tiny articles, it's still very interesting. Ben Ferraiuolo is an amateur seismologist, but one of the more respected on the internet for being very methodical in his analysis. If you're interested in the supervolcano Yellowstone, it's definitely worth following Ben on YouTube. And there are two articles right here. They're very short, but then again, this is the first time I've ever been mentioned on anyone's website. I mean, I think I was one time mentioned on somebody's blog, you know, just some random person, but this is totally different, you know? I think it's very interesting. I think it's pretty cool. Shows I'm on the right track, and hopefully I can get a career in seismology someday. It really interests me that much, so hope you guys have a great day. If you guys want to read these two articles that 95.5 My Country wrote about me, I'll leave a link in the description box below. Just know they're very short, though. Very short. But I'll leave a link to both these links in the description box. All right. I hope you guys have a great day. Let's see if any more earthquakes occurred while I was talking. Doesn't seem like it. Earlier, there was a 3.6 at 5 kilometers in depth in Texas. That's very interesting. Let's just real quick see how many people felt it. Just real fast. 21 people felt it. Nah, not too crazy. Okay, so that's pretty much it for right now, guys. I hope you all have a great day. God bless, and see you later.